November 22, 1963 changed the course of this country for all time.
This is part of the motorcade we did. We restaged it. The witnesses, potential shooter sites, are yelling, they're yelling.
We understand there has been a shooting. The presidential car coming up now. We know it's the presidential car. You see Mrs. Kennedy's pink suit. We can't see who has been hit, if anybody's been hit, but apparently something is wrong here. Something is terribly wrong.
I was in Dallas on the day the president died. We were stunned.
Just sat there stunned. Could not believe it.
I was in the third grade and I was sitting in class and our teacher came in crying and announced it.
I ended up in Nevada City drinking in a bar.
I remember the terrible sinking feeling I got.
All over the world, it was one of those events that just went straight through into everybody's heart.
He may not have been the greatest statement, the greatest this, the greatest that, or greatest anything, but my God, was he a leader.
Let the word go forth from this time and place to friend and foe alike, that the torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans,
a
proud of our ancient heritage,
and tyranny, poverty.
Mrs. Kennedy shot today just as the motorcade left downtown Dallas. Mrs. Kennedy jumped
what
up.
What your country can do for you, ask what you can do.
Fast forward to 1991. The motorcade of death returns to Dallas, only this time it is being restaged for the camera.
We're still rolling, folks, still rolling.
A scene in Oliver Stone's assassination investigation, the movie JFK.
John F. Kennedy's murder was probably one of the most terrible moments in the history of our country.
Secret Service? Should be an agent up here.
No one has ever restaged this assassination the way we are doing now. What we're doing is we're sort of acting as detectives, like Sherlock Holmes's.
JFK is a drama based on history, an argument for conspiracy, drawing on several books and years of research. To its critics, it is a Hollywood happening, an exploitation of reality.
JFK, while it's certainly skillfully put together, I would never deny that. I don't regard it as art, it's propaganda.
Even before its release, it touched off charges that it was distorting history by confusing fact and fiction.
You know, Chicago Tribune, Washington Post, and Time Magazine, they've had an agenda here to go after this film, to review a stolen first draft. And we are on our sixth draft. I'm not even shooting half of the things in the first draft, and they're reviewing that. It's never been done in the history of movies. There's an agenda here. These are trained Doberman Pinschers, these journalists. They're protecting something. They're protecting an old crime.
Well, I wouldn't argue the point whether or not journalism has failed us. I leave someone else to make that judgment. Obviously, I would be not the proper person to do it. But if the alternative is Hollywood, and particularly if the alternative is Oliver Stone and the movie JFK, then I think that's an even greater failure.
But have all the facts been determined? Can they be? Does history have only one possible interpretation? Was the president's murder the open and shut case that the government made it out to be with its reassuring Warren Commission? Did Oswald act alone, as so much of the press seemed to believe?
You go to Europe, you go to France and England and Italy, they are still amazed at the naivete of the American people, that they bought this one single lone nut assassin with his magic bullet, that Lee Oswald did it. They laugh at America's naivete, and they know that this was a political murder. They know it, and their press has always reflected that.
This debate is between two opposing views of America and its institutions. Whom do you trust? Government agencies or independent analysts? The Warren Report or its critics? The battle is even raging within the media itself. Newsweek carried a cover story denouncing JFK. Yet inside, the magazine's own critic praised it, warning, "Don't trust anyone who claims the movie is hogwash." Even journalists who covered the assassination disagree on the possibility of conspiracy.
Oh, I dismiss all of that. I think it's It's too Machiavellian for our people, frankly.
We've seen revealed one conspiracy after another. Anybody would have to be a fool nowadays to dismiss conspiracies. And perhaps we lived in a fool's paradise before the Kennedy assassination.
This documentary goes beyond the story told in JFK to examine certain realities that the film dramatizes.
And I jumped out in the street and yelled, you know, and started yelling at him, "Hey, Mr. President, look this way. We want to take your picture."
"Hey, Mr. President, look over here." He looked up, and then shots rang out.
And about that time, the shots rang out.
Beyond JFK revisits the case brought by Jim Garrison, the controversial New Orleans district attorney who prosecuted the only trial of the Kennedy assassination.
It's essential that the American people get off their behinds and try and do something about the murder of Jack Kennedy.
You'll meet the actor who brings Garrison's story to the screen, Kevin Costner.
He was a person that I believe was a patriot. Someone who'd served in wars, who had a genuine love of country.
"I'm just a patsy."
Was Oswald just a patsy? We'll ask the woman who knew him best, his wife Marina, who in the film endorses his guilt.
"And facts tell me that Lee shot Kennedy."
But now has questions of her own.
"You cannot honestly can say this man and only man did it and he's guilty."
Beyond JFK looks at the issues raised in Oliver Stone's film and investigates conspiracy theories that still haunt us as we remember that dark day in Dallas.
I was there when the bulletin came over, Merriman Smith's bulletin, that the shots had rung out in Dealey Plaza.
The press buses were pretty far back in the motorcade, and we didn't really know what had happened.
I had been out partying the night before, and I worked downtown, knew the president was going to be there that day.
I sort of fell asleep in the press bus, or half asleep, and had a kind of daydream in which I imagined what would happen if somebody took a shot at him.
My dad had stopped on Stimmons Freeway beyond those trees. He had stopped there to see the Kennedy motorcade go by.
It had turned the corner, and as it came right down, as it got toward me, it came over into this lane.
When there was a bang, and we all said, "Was that a shot? What was that? What was that?" And there was that enough time to say that, then there were two bang, bang, like that, very close together. And I was right at the front of the press bus, and I said, "Jesus, those are shots."
And I was taking pictures with my film, with my camera, which was an 8mm movie camera, and the nightmare happened.
And I jumped back upon the curb, and his head was blown off right in front of me.
I heard Jackie Kennedy scream, "Oh God, no."
He saw that Kennedy had been shot, and he was shocked, and he was very upset, and that he was slumped over in the seat. He saw the blood running down his head, and it scared him so much he wanted to find a police officer.
I ripped the material off the machine and ran for a announce booth that we had, shouting at the time, "Get me on the air, get me on the air."
The first reports say that President Kennedy has been seriously wounded by this shooting.
The air was filled with the most incredible screaming. It was as though there were 25 choirs all out of tune, just screaming at the tops of their lungs.
These things only happen in movies. They don't happen in real life. But there it was. It happened right before my eyes.
Then I noticed that policemen were running up the hill, the grassy slope, grassy knoll as it became to be known, and that there were people sitting there looking dazed, some still sort of half crouched over their children.
It was right up there. The man was shooting from right just this side of that tree, that large tree, and that's where I saw the shot come from.
There was a puff of smoke.
Right there.
At first, he thought it was a smoke from like a cigarette or a cigar. And then when he turned around, the gentleman turned around, my dad saw clearly that it was a rifle.
There were people running down there, and I thought, sure, they saw the guy that they was going after him.
So I ran up the grassy knoll around the people, came to the top, went to the fence, and I have pictures of myself by that fence.
Just talk us through it.
Okay, the man with the gun, with the suit, came walking this direction and threw the gun to the railroad man. He caught it, walked over towards the box, took the gun apart and put it in a toolbox. And then he just walked towards the railroad.
I ran along the top looking for a phone. The first building I came to that looked as though it had one turned out to be the Texas School Book Depository. Ran up the steps, young guy came out. I said, where's their phone? There's been a shooting. He showed me inside. I found a phone, got to NBC, did a little bulletin on the shots being fired. And I kept thinking, what an incredible story. What an incredible story. What an incredible story. It was like my own heartbeat telling me.
And it's even more incredible because the person you met outside the book depository may have been...
Yeah. Now, William Manchester thinks that the person I met was Lee Harvey Oswald, and he writes it so in The Death of the President.
President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago.
It was hard to speak the words. I choked a little bit on it and kind of hesitated, but was able to go on. I'm not at all ashamed of showing that emotion. I'm, matter of fact, proud that I was able to subdue it enough to continue.
After he saw Kennedy had been shot, he drove to the police department, and they said that they would not talk to him about the incident. He thought maybe that the fact that he was deaf, that they didn't feel that they wanted to take the time to communicate with him. It was stuck in his mind, and it was so hard for him to continue on. He'd sleep at night, think about it, wake up in a sweat.
For a long time, I felt quite strongly that that Lee Harvey Oswald was the lone assassin. I think there's enough evidence now that there certainly are doubts about that. I'm willing to concede those doubts. I don't know what happened.
Well, I hold to the view that he was a lone gunman, yes. I'm not sure as to whether it was a part of a conspiracy or not, however, any longer.
Why would professional policemen run up there after there was a gunshot, who are more experienced in listening to gunshots and hearing gunshots reverberate, the echoes reverberate off buildings, why would they be misled?
The Warren Commission says that it happened from the school book depository up right up there in that corner window. But I don't know about that. I don't know anything about those shots up there. All I know is what I saw from the note. And I definitely saw the man shooting from the note.
Well, I was always under the impression that Oswald had killed the president. I mean, that's... that was just taken as read, you know. There it was. It's chip, you know, it's in tablets of stone.
Did you kill the president?
No, I've not been charged with that. In fact, nobody has said that to me yet.
I request someone to come forward to give me a legal assistance.
You believe him. You look at that guy. I didn't shoot anyone. He keeps repeating, you know, I don't know what dispatches you people have been given, but I emphatically deny these charges. I mean, even when I was doing it, firing and cocking the gun, the adrenaline, plus the fact the gun he was using was a very old gun. I mean, a piece of shit. Something like 120 marksmen have tried to recreate what he did that day. They've not been able to do it. Why would he use ammunition that hadn't been used since like 1947? The gun cost, you know, $25. The telescopic sight on it, which was supposedly misaligned, was like $1.50. You can't do it. You can't do it. You can't do it.
Lee H. Oswald, O-S-W-A-L-D.
Did he confess, sir? Has he made a statement?
He has not confessed. He has made no statement. Charges of murder have been accepted against him.
Mr. Wade, could you elaborate on the physical evidence?
I don't care to go into the evidence now.
The suspect will be interrogated some more. At the same time, all the loose ends will be tied together in one neat package.
There were actually two conspiracies. One was to kill the president. That one obviously worked quite well.
and who was behind that, that's what we're still debating about. The second one, though, was the conspiracy to cover up the truth of the assassination, and that one didn't operate quite as well.
Critics say that a cover-up began within hours of the assassination with a botched, inept, and perhaps manipulated performance by federal agencies and the Dallas police.
This investigation has been carried on jointly by the FBI, the Secret Service, the Rangers, and the Dallas Police Department. Captain Rich has been in charge.
It was here that Oswald was interrogated for 12 hours, though no records were kept. There was confusion about the murder weapon and the lack of fingerprints to link him to the crime. It didn't seem to matter.
We have sufficient evidence to convict him.
Was this, is there any indication that this was an organized plot, or was it just one man?
There's no one else but him.
The evidence against Oswald was never presented in court. Jack Ruby, a nightclub owner with a history of mafia connections, saw to that.
So I squeezed in and pushed in with my elbows like this, and I didn't know that I was pushing in right in front of Jack Ruby, who was waiting to shoot him. I jumped in front of Oswald, and I said, do you have anything to say
in your defense? There's a shot.
Oswald has been shot.
Oswald has been shot.
Holy mackerel.
There was a big fight right in front of me. They were wrestling for the guns, and out comes a detective. And I said, who did that? And he said, Jack Ruby. And I pulled out a card to the Carousel Club that he had given me, and he knew exactly what was going on in that basement.
When Texas authorities and congressional committees announced plans to investigate, local rumors circulated that even the new president may have had a link to the killing.
I heard this myself. There were many people whose immediate reaction was that Lyndon Johnson had something to do with this.
To reassure a shocked nation, and some say to put an end to these rumors, President Johnson launched an investigation, appointing a prestigious commission headed by Chief Justice Earl Warren. Former President Gerald Ford, then a congressman, is the commission's last surviving member and remains its ardent defender.
We said that Lee Harvey Oswald was the assassin. We said that the commission had found no evidence of a conspiracy, foreign or domestic.
Critics say the commission's mandate was not so much to probe the crime as to prove that Oswald acted alone. FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover wanted it that way. The thing I am most concerned about, he wrote, is having something issued so we can convince the public that Oswald is the real assassin. With the commission acting as prosecutor, judge, and jury, Oswald was presented as the lone assassin. The crime was solved.
There was an unwillingness to believe, first of all, that it had happened, and then that it could have been anything but the act of one deranged man, untypical of the wholesome society that produced him. Which is why I think the Warren Commission findings fell on very receptive ears and fitted an emotional and psychological matrix that we all had prepared, and I include myself in that.
Though touted as open and unbiased, most commission hearings were held in secret, with the FBI framing the issues. Former Speaker of the House Tip O'Neill says Kennedy aides Ken O'Donnell and Dave Powers told him the FBI persuaded them to change their eyewitness testimony, which placed the fatal shot as coming from the grassy knoll.
I said, I can't understand it. I said, I've looked over the Warren report. I read your testimony in the Warren report, both of you. Both of you said that no question that Oswald is the one that shot Jack, that the bullet came from up there. Well, they said, the reason we testified that way, said Kenny, is that the FBI came to us and said, let's get this behind us. You're wrong. There had been an echo. That was an echo you heard. Both you and Dave are wrong in this. The family would like to get the thing behind it. There's no question that was only one shot. And he said, I went along with the FBI, and they said exactly what the FBI wanted us to say. And Dave said exactly the same thing as Ken.
The commission's 26 volumes of testimony were incomplete. Many witnesses were never called. Questions regarding medical evidence, including the autopsy performed on President Kennedy, were ignored. CIA and FBI files never subpoenaed.
We were concerned about what Mr. Hoover was doing. We were concerned about what the CIA was doing. And I believe that even though we did not get the information we should have in some particulars, that we found the correct conclusions.
Alan Dulles, fired by Kennedy as CIA director, was a key commissioner and the strongest advocate of its theory that Oswald acted alone. He kept silent about covert CIA activities that might have had a bearing on the case. While the CIA had its advocate, the FBI also received special treatment. Documents show that Gerald Ford was secretly relaying commission research to the Bureau. Ford has now added his voice to the chorus attacking Oliver Stone's JFK. He declined to be interviewed for this program. The Warren Report's most disputed conclusion was advanced by then staffer and now Senator Arlen Specter, seen here interrogating Anita Hill during recent Supreme Court confirmation hearings.
I think we found the real facts, and certainly no one in the intervening 25 years has disproved our basic conclusions.
It was Specter who came up with the so-called magic bullet theory, which tracks one bullet going through both Kennedy and Texas Governor John Connally. The bullet was later discovered virtually intact on Connally's hospital stretcher. JFK dramatizes questions about the number of shots and the speed with which the commission says Oswald fired them.
FBI tried two sets of tests. Not one of their sharpshooters could match Oswald's performance. Not one. And Oswald was at best a medium shot. The scope was defective on it, too. I mean, this is the whole essence of the case to me. The guy couldn't do the shooting.
No, I have not been charged
nobody
with that.
Could.
In fact, nobody
and they
said
sold
that.
This lemon to the American public.
The Warren Commission could not have sold its conclusions unless the mass media was prepared to buy them.
The Warren Commission report was released. The media jumped all over it as the final word in the controversy, and before the evidence was even available.
Advertising executive Jerry Polakoff has published several articles on the media coverage of the assassination.
I do think that the media sees itself as something of a protector of our basic institutions. I think the media is frightened by the prospect of the American people questioning those institutions, including the institution of the press.
In fact, New York Times columnist Tom Wicker criticizes JFK on precisely these grounds, that it weakens respect for American institutions. Like many other reporters, he rejects any suggestion of a media cover-up.
If I understand what you mean by cover-up, is you know what happened, or you at least you know how to find out what happened, and you deliberately don't do it because you don't want it to come out. I don't believe that was ever the case with the American press.
But did the media do all it could to investigate the Kennedy assassination? This question is at the heart of the assassination debate.
There is a predisposition still on the part of the mainstream media to believe it all works, the system works. And it's only the sort of crazies on the fringes who want to keep saying, no, it doesn't work, no, it doesn't work, there's a conspiracy at work. And the two are converging all the more because the evidence has brought them together.
I've seen a lot of strange things here.
This film is not based on fact. What was fact? That stupid report, the cover-up? The Warren report, the disappointing, terrible thing from that great man? It was a whitewash, a total whitewash.
Those Warren Commission fellas were picking that shit out of pepper.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think Earl Warren said, we're not going to know the truth for 75 years. And it's better that we don't, because too many of our hallowed institutions would be shaken.
My character is skeptical. Not only is she skeptical, she doesn't want to believe it.
I think you care more about John Kennedy than your own family.
And I think that's probably a way that a lot of us are.
On the day it happened, hundreds scrambled to the place they thought shots were coming from. Not to the school book depository, but to a place known as the Grassy Knoll. In November 1991, the knoll was invaded again, this time by a horde of assassination aficionados. They came from 38 states and 8 countries, people whose lives are consumed with the details of what happened here in Dealey Plaza. They are assassination buffs in Dallas for a conspiracy convention.
If we could have the little bit of evidence that still remains, that's locked up, with that information, we could, and a public investigation could solve this case in 5 working days. 5 days.
Seeking to renew interest in the case, the convention took on the feel of a religious revival. Cyril Wecht is a forensic pathologist.
My God, isn't it important to do the kind of simple physical experiment that can be done in this case? You get a Mannlicher Corcano, you get 6.5 millimeter ammunition, you get cadavers, you get carcasses, and you shoot, and you shoot, and you shoot, and you shoot, and you shoot! How long can it take? How many cases will you need to prove that you will never get a bullet that will go through 2 bones like that and come out unscathed and pristine as CE?
It's the medical scientific evidence that demonstrates clearly that there were 2 or more shooters. Once we've done that, then believe me, those pins will begin to fall, that house of cards will begin to collapse so fast that heads will spin. People will begin to run for cover. And then, whosever theory is more correct, what difference does it make?
The problem in this case is, and what my book is all about, is that the body apparently was altered between the time of the shooting and the time the autopsy was conducted that night. And so it is supposed to be the best evidence. The body of President Kennedy instead became the mechanism by which history was deceived.
This is the second Oswald theory. In other words, what they're saying is that there were 2 Oswalds and they were switched. This is an anti-conspiracy book. In other words, this says, hey, it was Oswald. He was a lone gunman. He was a nut. He went out. He shot the president.
Those are the doodlings of Jack Ruby.
Some, like legal secretary Mary Farrell, are homegrown experts.
That's the FBI's file on Jack Ruby. J. Edgar Hoover said that there was no connection between the FBI and either Jack Ruby or Lee Harvey Oswald. Well, that's not true.
We have a copy of the 6.5 Italian Carcano that was supposedly found on the 6th floor after the assassination. The rifle at that time period cost approximately $12.88. The Italians called it the humane weapon because it couldn't hit anything.
If it were 1963 all over again, I wouldn't get involved. Makes you too cynical, spend too much of your money, and takes up a lot of your life. See, there's probably something inherently unhealthy psychologically about knowing more about a day 28 years ago than you know about yesterday. That's probably not good for you.
For these researchers, the investigation is a hall of mirrors, a quicksand of plausible scenarios.
We got the lone assassin theory, Castro did it theory, the Russians did it theory, the mob did it theory.
Many puzzle over the motives and personas that most novelists would have trouble inventing, like alleged assassin Lee Harvey Oswald.
I don't know what this is all about.
There were 2 Oswalds. There was the public Oswald, lone nut assassin with no connection to anybody who just happened to take 4 bullets and a rifle into the book depository and squeeze off 3 shots in 5.6 seconds and miraculously hit the president. A pro-communist, a man who had defected to Russia, a man who was a pro-Castro.
Like you say, he was a complicated person, and these things are hard to figure out. But he appeared to me to be pro-Castro when I first met him.
And yet, the other Oswald was quite different. Anti-communist, virulently anti-communist, anti-Castro Cubans. That's who he was actually in contact with.
Before I, parted company with him, he became anti-Castro, sort of.
Lee was pronounced guilty under circumstantial evidence, and that's all over with.
Another Oswald expert, his wife Marina, wants us to remember that her husband was never tried.
Wife of assassin, and that legal stigma that attached. I hope in my lifetime will be changed. But wishing for it doesn't make it come true.
If Oswald's guilt is disputed, Jack Ruby's is indisputable. But Ruby's role is still a hot topic.
There have been many witnesses who have testified that Oswald knew Ruby, and witnesses who have testified that they saw Ruby and Oswald together in the Carousel nightclub in a certain downtown cafeteria, but it was has never been established beyond reasonable doubt that they did know each other.
We saw Lee Harvey Oswald in there. We saw him talking to Jack Ruby.
Lee Harvey Oswald?
Was in the Carousel Club.
How do you know?
I saw him.
Jack introduced me to this man as his friend, Lee Oswald, with the CIA.
They would talk about running guns to Cuba, and we would turn a deaf ear. There was a lot of things we heard we didn't want to know.
This person named Lee was, I would say, a very dark character. I don't know how else to. He was very moody. He seemed to be in a very belligerent mood. He was, in fact, rather rude.
Many researchers charge that not all the witnesses have been able to testify.
I call them convenient deaths. They were convenient for anyone who wanted to stop the flow of information concerning the assassination. One died in a fall, and one died of a heart attack, and one died in a shot in his backyard, mistaken for a deer. We have to ask ourselves, where does coincidence leave off and where does conspiracy begin?
But what may be the most effective witness is a home movie of the killing that shocked Congress into reopening the case in 1977. The film was introduced at the convention by photo analyst Robert Groden.
Third shot, Connolly. And the headshot.
Abraham Zapruder, the man who took the film of the assassination, was standing on that pedestal where that man is standing now. He's standing right where Zapruder was. The Zapruder film is a clock for the assassination. So we know that a shot hits Governor Connolly 1.6 seconds after President Kennedy is hit in the back. That is far too long for a, quote, delayed reaction. The obvious conclusion is that if Oswald's weapon was used, there had to be at least one other person firing.
If Robert Groden is the eyes of the conspiracy industry...
Are you charging the Chief Justice with a cover-up?
Yes, I'm...
Mark Lane has been its best mouthpiece since 1964 with the best-selling book and film, Rush to Judgment.
I emphatically deny these charges.
If he had lived, of course, he would be entitled to counsel. I think he is entitled to counsel now, and I think all of America now is entitled to have counsel for Lee Oswald.
Today, Lane is even more controversial with a new book, Plausible Denial, claiming that the CIA killed Kennedy.
This was the Central Intelligence Agency which organized it. It was Marita Lorenz, who was working for the CIA, who went with Frank Sturgis, who was working for the CIA, to Dallas, where they met the paymaster of the operation, E. Howard Hunt, who was working for the CIA, all according to Marita's testimony.
In November, that we took a trip, I thought, to New Orleans, but it ended up being Dallas.
She's an interesting woman. She was recruited by the CIA to kill Fidel Castro, with whom she had had an affair. But then she was recruited to do a number of things, running, picking up guns, acting as a decoy, picking up guns in Miami.
We brought high-powered weapons with scopes and assassination material.
And it was Frank Sturgis who later told Marita, Lorenz, we, the CIA operatives, killed John F. Kennedy.
And he said, well, we got Kennedy. And I said, you're not serious. Is that what you were there for that time when you sent me back? And he said, yes. He said, who the F is going to know?
Convicted Watergate burglars Frank Sturgis and E. Howard Hunt have denied any role in the assassination.
We need a special prosecutor who can take evidence before a grand jury. This is what we would do if it were any other crime, important crime. Why not this case? If a dog were run over in front of Dealey Plaza, the whole question would go through the judicial system. The president was killed. We don't believe the government's told us the truth, and they don't care that we don't believe it. That's the problem.
As you probably all realize, we have a few interesting pieces on sale tonight. The Gun News by Jack Ruby, Lee Harvey Oswald, on November the 24th, 1963. 38 caliber Cobra revolver. I have $100,000.
The gun is owned by Earl Ruby, who is Jack Ruby's brother.
I say 105,000.
When he saw Oswald come out with a snicker on his face, although he was proud that he killed Kennedy, just ticked my brother off.
$120,000 I have bid. $125,000 I have.
You don't assassinate anybody by shooting him in the stomach.
$130,000 I have. $135,000. $135,000 I have bid.
He told me he just wanted to hurt him and make him suffer a little bit.
$170,000, $180,000.
How can you say I'm profiting? I won't even get enough to pay the bills, unless I'm really lucky.
$190,000. $200,000 I have paid. Both of the other people here, $200,000.
I know my brother. He loved Kennedy. Well, it's ludicrous that they try to involve him in a conspiracy. I know better, and he was sorry he shot him. He never thought he would die.
There has only been one conspiracy trial in the Kennedy assassination. It was brought by then New Orleans District Attorney Jim Garrison.
The real killer of John Kennedy was a Central Intelligence Agency, and John Kennedy was not the only American leader murdered by the CIA. He was just the greatest.
This man has been described by the Northern press and even the Southern press as a fraud and as a wide-eyed lunatic.
He couldn't produce a thing that made any sense.
He dealt with certain facts convenient to him while avoiding other facts that weren't convenient to him.
Here he was, a local district attorney. What reason did he have to be investigating the President of the United States?
Jim Garrison is surely a controversy unto himself, a controversy within a controversy. Even many people who think that he was absolutely correct about the assassination and the conspiracy behind it think that Garrison was a wild man and that he did more harm than good. I can see the reasons for the complaints. I've looked at them fairly closely because I've done a study of Garrison. I come out of it thinking that he's one of the really first-rate class act heroes of this whole ugly story, which suffers so badly for heroes.
As children, we become accustomed to hearing fairy tales. They're always pleasant stories, and they're comforting to hear because good always triumphs over evil. At least, this is the way it is in fairy tales. However, in the real world in which you and I must live, fairy tales are dangerous. They're dangerous because they're untrue. The conclusion of the Warren Report that President Kennedy was killed by a lone assassin is a fairy tale.
I found Jim Garrison to be a very conservative man, someone rooted deeply in American tradition. He had been in the FBI, and he was a prosecutor for 12 years. This was not a flaming radical by any means.
He was known as the Jolly Green Giant down in New Orleans. The people down there really liked him immensely. They had seen how independent he had been in going after rackets down there and in taking the judges to task for not putting in enough time on the bench.
Jim Garrison was a feisty district attorney in New Orleans. And the very weekend of the assassination, as most good district attorneys, he had lots of tentacles out in the community and on the street. And he immediately began to get feedback that that Oswald had been there and that people had seen Oswald with various people, including David Ferry. And Oswald apparently had been in touch with David Ferry all the way back to the age of 15 when he had served in the Civil Air Patrol under David Ferry.
David Ferry was a very strange individual. He spoke five languages. He suffered from a rare illness called alopecia, where he had no hair on all over his body.
David Ferry was a guy who would glue his own wig on, and he put mohair above his eyes to simulate eyebrows. And he more or less looked like a Halloween pumpkin.
Dave, as you know, President Kennedy was assassinated on Friday. A man named Lee Harvey Oswald was arrested as a suspect and was then murdered yesterday by a man named Jack Ruby. We've heard reports that Oswald spent the summer here in New Orleans, and we've been advised that you knew Oswald pretty well.
I never met anybody named Oswald. Anybody told you that has to be crazy.
Ferry, a very mysterious character, was arrested 2 days after the assassination on suspicions of having participated in a conspiracy to assassinate President Kennedy, was interrogated at great length by the Secret Service and the FBI, and then was released.
There was one event that struck him as being very funny. He investigated it very early on, turned the information over to a government agency, the FBI,
feeling that there was enough there to investigate, they did not conclude the same thing, which caused his office a little bit of concern, like, gee, you know, we happen to think this is a very interesting thing. The FBI said, no, we don't believe that this is. And Jim let it lay. He let it lay for 3 years.
It was about 1966 when, you might say, I awoke from my dogmatic slumber, because like so many American people, I found it impossible to believe that the United States government would lie to us about something like this. Two things triggered me in two steps. First was a conversation I had with Senator Russell Long talking about the assassination, and he mentioned to me that there was no way in the world that that kid, meaning Lee Oswald, could have shot up that car, and meaning Jack Kennedy and Governor Connally, the way that they say he did. And I said, are you telling me that you think the Warren Commission lied, that that was all a lie? He said, absolutely, it had to be a lie.
The possibility of a conspiracy originating in New Orleans should have been investigated, and it was investigated by FBI agents and perhaps by Secret Service agents. Whether they found everything that was to be found is entirely a different matter.
So I sent off for the Warren Commission volume, the whole 26 volumes, 26 volumes plus a report, started digging into it, and it was boring reading because one of the first things I discovered was most of the people they called had nothing to do with it. And early on, I sensed that this was a snow job to keep the facts from becoming clear. If you look at the Zapruder film, one of the first things you see is he was killed by a shot from the front. So one of the first things I did when I had was in the right position for it, I issued a subpoena for the Zapruder film to Life magazine, and they had to produce it.
The last thing that came up for him was, that really startled him, was when he read that Lee Harvey Oswald had been given a Russian test while in the Marines.
I saw the testimony of Colonel Folsom of the Marines. He mentioned the test Oswald had just taken in Russian. And somebody must have kicked him under a table, because he quickly added, he didn't do too well. He got almost as many wrong as he got right. Well, of course, that was, to me, just like somebody saying, my dog is really stupid, because when we play chess, I can beat him 3 games out of 5.
He defected to the Soviet Union. He came back to the United States, where he was greeted with open arms. Nobody prosecuted him. Nobody said, you rejected your citizenship. You renounced it before. You're not allowed back here. He could bring back a Russian woman.
When Oswald returns to New Orleans in the summer of 63, he begins to pass out this communist literature. On this literature was an address, and the address was 544 Camp Street.
Saturday morning, by myself, I got up early and went down to 544 Camp Street, and the building looked familiar, and I realized as I went around the corner to look at the other entrance that this was the old office in 1963 of Guy Bannister.
Sure, Guy Bannister, ex-FBI man, died a couple years ago.
Used to recruit college students, infiltrate radical organizations on campus, headed the Anti-Communist League of the Caribbean, all out of this office.
It was an old antiquated building on the corner of Lafayette and Camp, right near Lafayette Square, and Bannister had his office there. I had been in it on occasion, and I went in there one time with Lee to view some arms that they had brought from an old blimp base, David Ferry and Lee and Jack Ruby.
Why Oswald was associated with that particular address remains one of the critical pieces of evidence in this whole investigation, and it indicates very strongly that all his passing out leaflets and literature favorable to Fidel Castro on the streets of New Orleans that summer actually was posturing to set up some type of an intelligence scenario.
Guy Bannister's office served as headquarters for something that we later found out was called Operation Mongoose. He found that David Ferry was one of the main people who was around there all the time, and that Bannister was running a training camp north of Lake Pontchartrain, very close to New Orleans, for Cuban exiles, right-wing mercenaries, They were training for a what they hoped would be another invasion of Cuba. And they had amassed huge stockpiles of weapons and ammunition that were constantly being brought in and out of Guy Bannister's office, right in the center of the intelligence community. This had to be noticed by the FBI and the CIA offices that were right in proximity. While conducting his investigation, Jim ran across in the Warren Commission volumes an interview with Dean Andrews. Jim happened to know him because they'd attended law school together at Tulane. On Saturday, the day after the assassination of President Kennedy, Andrews had received a strange phone call from a man named Clay Bertrand asking him, Andrews, to go to Dallas to represent Lee Harvey Oswald as his attorney.
Well, Clay Bertrand, whoever the real man would be, might be, is one of the participants in the assassination. And a man named Dean Andrews is protecting him by not giving his real name. I decided I wanted his real name. So I set up a meeting at lunch.
Well, I don't know what he's up to. He's picking me like chicken, shucking me like corn, stewing me like an oyster. I mean, he ain't putting nothing down but air.
Dean, are you trying to tell me that you received a call from Clay Bertrand, who's a client of, who was a client of yours, but you don't know what he looks like because you've never seen him, and he'd say, scout's on him, my man.
He's got the right ta-ta, but the wrong ho-ho.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to call you into the grand jury, and I spoke some of his language, so to speak. I said, now, when you dance into the grand jury, you better lay the truth on him, or else you are going to be indicted and go to trial for perjury. We tried him, and the jury found him guilty.
So Jim wanted to find out who this Clay Bertrand was. Since he got nowhere with Dean Andrews, he decided to look into the French Quarter, where most of Dean Andrews' clientele came from.
So we started hitting those bars every night and asking bartenders who Clay Bertrand was. Well, first we were bumping against a stone wall, but one of our assistants had grown up in the Sixth Ward. One of his relatives happened to know this bartender and called and said, that, why don't you just tell him the truth? And so we went back and asked the man again, and he was perfectly candid. He said, sure. He said, I don't know why they're not telling you, but everybody down here in the quarter knows who Clay Bertrand is. That's Mr. Shaw, Clay Shaw.
This came as a great shock because Clay Shaw was one of the most upstanding and respected members of the community in New Orleans. He was a pillar of society. He had done a lot to restore the city, and he had been the founder of the International Trademark.
He could become the ambassador to the court of St. James tomorrow, and English wouldn't blink an eye because he would fit into the world of diplomacy so beautifully, and yet he never graduated from college.
Shaw denied knowing Oswald, denied knowing Ferry, denied knowing any of the people who identified him as Clay Bertrand.
I am not Clay Bertrand.
But Jim kept looking, and what they came across was a rumor that Shaw, Ferry, and Oswald had been spotted together in a little town called Clinton.
Garrison located witnesses in Clinton, Louisiana, who would testify that in 1963, during the drive to get blacks to register to vote, that Lee Harvey Oswald showed up at the voters' registration site, and he was accompanied by Clay Shaw and David Ferry.
Now, what would a guy like Clay Shaw be doing with someone like David Ferry? Okay, what would a guy like Clay Shaw be doing with somebody like Lee Harvey Oswald? Okay, but witness after witness testified about this Clinton trip.
With Clay Shaw, another part of the evidence that Garrison had acquired was a party that was attended supposedly by Clay Shaw, by Lee Harvey Oswald, and David Ferry at Ferry's apartment. And the witness in this case, who also attended the party, Perry Russo, said that they discussed an assassination of John Kennedy.
I went up there and walked up his spiral staircase, up the steps, and I met Oswald. I had met Shaw. I met Shaw there. I had seen Shaw before and was introduced. There were several Cubans. We talked about different things. And Ferry was in a heated mood, he came up with ideas on assassinating Castro. He came up with ideas on assassinating Kennedy and blame it on somebody that likes Castro.
And the conspiracy under the law is the same as committing the murder. It was my jurisdiction, New Orleans. It was my duty to locate and prosecute anybody in New Orleans that had something to do with assassination, and I got somebody when we got Clay Shaw.
Up until this point, Jim's investigation had been conducted in entire secrecy. It was funded by publicly accountable funds, and they had used about $8,000. An enterprising young reporter, Rosemary James, had tracked the accounts and had found out that money had been used for the Kennedy investigation.
Dave Snyder and I, who was also a reporter for the State's Item, spent quite a bit of time talking to people, and eventually we had enough for a story.
It goes public. And once they decide that it's on the JFK plot, the entire press of the Western world descends on New Orleans. The second thing that happens is that David Ferry mysteriously dies about a week later.
The circumstances of his death to this day have never been satisfactorily explained. And he had a direct link to Oswald. He had a link to Clay Shaw.
Jim made it what he called a command decision. That was to arrest Clay Shaw and charge him with conspiring to murder the president. I think he felt that he didn't have quite the case that he would have liked to if he had been able to keep it secret. But since he had been forced into the public eye, he wanted to make sure he had Clay Shaw before Clay Shaw mysteriously disappeared.
Quiet!
All right, Bill, will you start again? Mr. Shaw is in custody at this time.
Where?
I said the arrest was made in this office. Mr. Shaw has jailed him.
I don't want to comment in any way on Mr. Shaw because I want to lean over backwards not to infringe on any of his rights.
I think it was the most evil bringing in an innocent man, Clay Shaw, and pillaring him in the public eye, or attempting to, and causing him great difficulties, of course.
Garrison's main theory is that it was a branch of the CIA that had more or less decided to do this on their own. Shaw, it turns out, had a long record of contacts with the CIA.
Later on, we found out that Shaw was a CIA man, that in fact he had been a colonel in the OSS during World War II.
I know he was the director of the at the International Trade Mart, where we had information that he was involved with the CIA. In fact, I was told that by Dave Ferry.
Clay Shaw was arrested on March 1st, 1967. Jim was under a great deal of pressure, and what he did was he presented his case before a grand jury, and the grand jury returned an indictment against Shaw on charges of conspiring to murder the president. At that point, strange things began happening in Jim's office. He found that the FBI had bugged his offices. Everywhere Jim traveled, FBI was following him.
We were so naive. We were like children. The office had been thoroughly penetrated, and in many cases files were missing, and in other cases files were turned over wholesale amounts to the defense. They had more of our files than we had when the case started.
Got no cooperation at all from the FBI. Tried to get different witnesses before our grand jury to testify under oath, you know, which were blocked by the federal government.
Mr. Garrison, do you feel that your case has really been hurt by this lack of cooperation with the federal government?
As to preventing us from being successful, there's no chance in the world. I'm sure that they think they can.
It was in March of 1967 that Clay Shaw was charged with conspiring to kill President Kennedy. Now, almost 2 years later, Shaw will go on trial here in this building tomorrow morning.
The trial took place in February of 1969, lasted a month. There were a lot of witnesses. The world press again came down to New Orleans, and it was a circus-like atmosphere. It happened to coincide, the beginning of it, with Mardi Gras, but that only contributed to the sense that this was a media circus.
What do you think of the treatment you're getting from the news media?
Who writes your questions? Your switchboard operator? I'll see you all later.
When you come to work in the morning and you'd see in the hallway reporters
from all over the world, practically breaking the door down. We had to have security guards at the doors so that everybody just wouldn't come pile in. You felt this was important, what you were doing. This was important.
You had reporters from all over the United States. You even had them from Russia. And I was aware of the fact that this was being written up all over the country. Whether or not they proved the conspiracy on the part of Shaw with other people, that's a separate legal point. But I certainly thought there was sufficient evidence to warrant bringing it to trial. Let a jury decide it.
Now let me tell you why President Kennedy was murdered and how he was murdered. If you, the people of the United States, will learn the truth that the president was assassinated by men who were once connected with a Central Intelligence Agency, of course, this might reflect on the dignity of the CIA. But I happen to believe that our form of government is strong enough to survive the truth. And I believe that the people of America want to know the entire truth about how their president was shot down in the streets of Dallas. And I want to assure you that as long as I am alive, no one is going to stop me from seeing that you obtain the full truth. And nothing less than the full truth, and no fairy tales.
That was a feeling that I'll never forget when the jury went out when they were deliberating. We felt confident that we did a job we thought we had to do, and I have seen some of our hard-nosed assistants, you know, when that jury came back with the verdict, actually broke down.
There's a number of things that I believe that Shaw testified to that I did not believe. I believe he was lying to the jury. Of course, the jury probably believed him. But I think Shaw put a good con job on the jury.
It took the jury, I think, only about a half hour to exonerate him from all charges. He was declared not guilty. He, nevertheless, it ruined a man's life.
No, I think that's a fair statement. I have been financially ruined. This is not to say that I'm starving to death now, you understand. But in comparison to what I had and what I have, I've been financially ruined, yes.
That was a frivolous prosecution. It was a prosecution that was of Clay Shaw. It was dismissed almost instantly. No one other than Jim Garrison has ever tried to revive it. No one has said other than Jim Garrison, this really is what happened or anything of the sort. I think it's a thoroughly discredited investigation.
The jury later said they were convinced by the case that Garrison put on that there was a conspiracy in the John Kennedy assassination, but they weren't convinced beyond reasonable doubt that Clay Shaw was involved in it.
I ask you, Mr. Garrison, if you had it to do over again, would you launch another investigation?
Yes, I would have to, because once you know that something was hidden, once you know what happened, then you have no choice. But I would say that I would do it with a great deal of reluctance, because it never occurred to me that so many people would take it for granted that I would lie about such a subject. But now that I've discovered that a large segment of the American press takes it for granted that you are automatically a liar because you're elected to office, I would go in again, but I would go in with more reluctance.
I say that despite enormous adversity and terrific opposition of a secret kind from the U.S. government, Garrison nevertheless managed to get his hands on somebody who appears to have been connected somehow to this case. No, Clay Shaw was not an assassin. No, Clay Shaw probably was not even an assassin's handler. But yes, Clay Shaw, along with David Ferry and Guy Bannister, did have something very definitely to do with manipulating Oswald during the summer of 1963 when Oswald was playing intelligence fun and games in New Orleans.
You know, we support our governments. Our governments are answerable to us, are accountable, that's a better word. And Jim was just trying to get at that fundamental idea that we are not content to just take the word of very powerful people, because in Jim's own words, he's seen powerful people and he's not impressed.
Maybe your government isn't always out for you. Sometimes it is. Sometimes it's Jack Kennedy who's the one who's out for you, and they get to him first. So that means people should know more about the country they live in and the meaning of public relations and foreign policy, because they are involved and they can't keep it away by pushing it away. And the same thing's true about the continued concealment of the murder of John Kennedy. They can't put it away, they have to confront it.
I never realized Kennedy was so dangerous to the establishment. Is that why?
Well, that's a real question, isn't it? Why?
If you start to ask that question, then you begin to understand the conception of the vastness of the crime.
The how and the who is just scenery for the public. Oswald, Ruby, Cuba, the mafia.
It's like a red herring. It's interesting. It's like a parlor game. But it takes you away from the central issue, which is what was Kennedy doing that was irritating people?
Why was Kennedy killed?
What was he shaking? What boat was he rocking?
Who benefited?
What threat to power did he represent?
Who has the power to cover it up? Who?
Let every nation know, whether it wishes us well or ill, that we shall pay any price.
John F. Kennedy began his presidency an eloquent cold warrior, but many believe he was starting to change course when he was killed. Since his death, the spread of covert power has posed a constant threat to American democracy.
I will tell you right now, counsel, and all the members here gathered, that I misled the Congress. This nation.
Conspiracies happen in America. The Iran-Contra affair, today's BCCI scandal, and yesterday's Watergate revelations.
I began by telling the president that there was a cancer growing on the presidency.
All suggest the existence of a secret government which invokes national security to conceal corrupt and often illegal activities.
The country has become accustomed to, conditioned to conspiracies at the very heart, in the very breast of its own government. And that event triggered a chain of events which have destroyed much of the credibility in the very institutions that everybody wanted to believe immediately afterwards.
A congressional committee found a probable conspiracy in the Kennedy assassination and asked the Justice Department to pursue its probe. It didn't. But private citizens have stayed on the trail, generating conflicting theories, many plausible, few with definitive proof.
We ought to be, at a certain point, a little careful as to how we interpret these events. We have to be very careful about that, because we can too easily fly off into the ether of our own special theories, and our imagination can get the better of us in this case.
A recent poll says 73% of all Americans now believe there was a conspiracy. Which forces had the motives, the means, and the opportunity to kill John Kennedy? The most popular conspiracy theories involve the mafia, the CIA, the FBI, the military-industrial complex, and for many years, the communists. Today, it is only the extreme right that is still menaced by the red menace.
I think the Cubans, I think Fidel Castro had Kennedy assassinated. In fact, about 3 weeks or 4 weeks before the assassination, they paraded a coffin through the streets of Havana and said, "Here lies President John F. Kennedy."
Fidel Castro denies any involvement in the assassination, claiming it would have been madness that would have provoked a U.S. invasion. In this never-broadcast 1974 interview, Castro says he was in a meeting with a French journalist that Kennedy had sent to explore a new policy when they first heard the news of the assassination.
Unquestionably, there was a move on the part of Kennedy to establish a contact and an exchange of views with us, and I was listening attentively to everything that the envoy was telling me about his conversation with Kennedy when the first pieces of news came over on the radio that there had been an attempt on Kennedy's life. We understood straight away the implications of this situation, and it worried us, the possibility that it might be used against Cuba. But we didn't have a personal conflict with him, no special motive to wish his death, and more. After the death of Kennedy, another could come, and no one knew who he was.
If the right fingered Castro, the left was suspicious of conspirators closer to home. Theory number two contends that Texas oilmen, fed up with Kennedy's threats to their oil depletion tax breaks and defense contracts, funded the triggermen. Madeline Brown knew these oil barons and witnessed their deep resentment of the Kennedys.
H.L. Hunt was passing out several days prior to the assassination the wanted for treason. And I told him at the time, I said, H.L., you're going to get yourself in trouble. You cannot do the President of the United States that way. And he said, he remarked, the hell I can. I'm the richest man in the world, and I never get in trouble.
Madeline Brown may have had a unique vantage point into the world of Texas politics. She claims to have had a long affair and a son with Lyndon Johnson.
I have double-checked on that. There are documents. There's letters from Johnson's lawyers. Plus, I have checked with friends of mine in the press corps who had followed Johnson on the campaign trail, and they all just grin and say, oh, yeah, Madeline Brown. It was an open secret.
Brown remembers Johnson fondly.
He was wonderful. He was as powerful in the bed, you might say, as he was in politics.
Brown says she once asked her lover what he knew about the Kennedy assassination.
I'd met him on New Year's, following the assassination, New Year's Eve. And I said, Lyndon, I said, people in Dallas are talking that you had something to do with the assassination. And he became very, very violently angry. And at that time, though, he did tell me it was the oil people that I knew here in Dallas and the CIA. And he slammed the door after he told me, he said he'd said too much to me. And, of course, my body went to, like, number 10 on a Richter scale. I couldn't believe that all of it was so ugly.
In 1969, Lyndon Johnson surprised Walter Cronkite with his own doubts about the Warren Commission.
He kind of mused, almost sotto voce, said, but on the other hand, you know, I've always thought, you know, there could have been a conspiracy there.
After reviewing the interview transcript, Johnson insisted his conspiracy remarks be deleted on the grounds of national security.
He was so persuasive and put such pressure on Bill Paley, the president of the network, that we abandoned that quote, didn't use it, which makes me feel that it was even more important.
Shortly before he died, Johnson told another journalist, we had been operating a murder incorporated in the Caribbean, which leads to conspiracy theory number three, linking the assassination to elements in the CIA and its anti-Castro crusade.
I would say that we're going to find the assassins of John Kennedy somewhere in the vicinity of the CIA Operations Directorate that had mobilized the anti-Castro Cuban community.
The assault has begun on the dictatorship of Fidel Castro.
This is the event that turned Cuban exiles against Kennedy, the CIA's disastrous Bay of Pigs invasion of Cuba in 1961. Planned by the Eisenhower administration, Kennedy reluctantly pursued the invasion, but refused at the last minute to provide air support.
Kennedy blamed the CIA for the failure of the Bay of Pigs. There were many in the CIA and many in the military who blamed Kennedy's refusal to directly use American air power for that failure.
Crushed by the Cuban army, the right-wing exiles were furious and vowed revenge. At that time, Perry Russo supported the Cuban exiles in New Orleans and still voices the sense of betrayal that they felt.
I shared a view that the direction of the federal government in 1963 was completely anti-American. That we had stabbed the Cubans in the back, what else were we going to allow to happen to this country before we stood up?
We intend to profit from this lesson. We intend to re-examine and reorient our forces of all kinds.
If the Cubans saw Kennedy as their enemy, JFK began to see the CIA as his.
Later on, there was a newspaper headline, the New York Times, a subheadline, Kennedy Bitterness, which quoted Kennedy as saying, I'm going to take the CIA, break into 1,000 pieces, and cast the pieces into the winds. They were finished.
But Kennedy had played their game too, presiding over coup and assassination attempts against foreign leaders. Could these same tactics blow back and be used against him?
The strongest motive to kill somebody is self-defense. And these intelligence officers were the same intelligence officers who had been participating in plots to assassinate Castro, Lumumba, the Diem brothers, Papa Doc Duvalier, world leaders that they didn't agree with all around the country, all around the world. So is it any stretch of the imagination that in their fear and in self-defense that they simply sent their hit squads to Dallas?
The day that communist son of a bitch died was a great day for this country. And I just hate to think.
Kevin Bacon's character in JFK dramatizes the hatred that some felt.
People got to know why he was killed. Because he was communist.
The CIA conscripted yet another ally in its anti-Castro crusade, the Mafia. Determined to regain their lucrative casinos in Havana, Mafia chiefs accepted an agency contract to kill Castro.
We should be investigating our Mafia leads here in New Orleans. Now, I can buy that a hell of a lot easier than I can the government. Ruby is all mob, knows Oswald, sets him up. Hopper, Trafficante, Marcellus, they hire some guns to do Kennedy. And the government doesn't want to open up a whole can of worms there because it used the mob to try to get to Castro.
Enter the Mafia conspiracy, theory number 4.
It's been said so many times that your associates are more dangerous than the federal government, sir. Is that true?
The mob had its own scores to settle with Kennedy, and some believe the assassination was a Mafia hit.
There were two people in the United States whose lives really were protected by Kennedy's death, Carlos Marcello and Jimmy Hoffa. The facts relate Marcello particularly to this crime.
Reporter Jonathan Quitney produced a TV program on the issue, linking Jack Ruby and even Oswald to Carlos Marcello, the Mafia chieftain of New Orleans. Marcello had threatened to kill Kennedy after being forcibly deported to Guatemala.
You have anything to say in your defense?
Quitney believes that Ruby was working for his old mob friends when he shot and killed Oswald. After his arrest, Ruby intimated that he had a lot more to say.
It's a complete conspiracy, Watson. If you knew the true facts, you'd be amazed at it. In what way? It'll be proven in a few days later what the charges will be filed against me, plus the fact of the assassination. A complete conspiracy against me, right?
But Jack Ruby never told his full story. Fearing for his life in Dallas, he asked the Warren Commission to bring him to Washington.
See, if I'm eliminated, there won't be any way of knowing any bit of the truth pertaining to my situation. And consequently, a whole new form of government is going to take over this country. Yeah, and I know that I won't live to see you some other time. Because I want to tell the truth, and then I want to leave this world.
While leaving the hearings, after these people had testified regarding this matter, did you say, that SOB, I'll break his back?
The Mafia and corrupt union officials like Jimmy Hoffa hated the Kennedys because for years they had spearheaded investigations into organized crime.
Well, who did you make the statement? Whose back were you going to break?
I don't even remember it.
Well, whose back were you going to break, Mr. Hoffa?
They gave his speech. I don't even know who I was talking about, and I don't know what you're talking about.
Hoffa became outraged with Bobby Kennedy. He was going to firebomb his house. And Ed Parton said, listen, Jim, if you're going to kill Bob Kennedy, go ahead, kill Bob Kennedy. But don't kill his family. And Hoffa replied, no, to hell with them, they're Kennedys, I want them all dead.
The Kennedys had enemies within their own administration as well. Top cop J. Edgar Hoover sometimes acted as if the Kennedys were more of a threat than the Mafia.
J. Edgar Hoover probably knew that there was a plot afoot to assassinate President Kennedy. He didn't tell the Secret Service about the plot. He didn't tell either one of the Kennedys about the plot. He wanted it to happen, because he hated the Kennedys and he was fearful that he was going to be retired as FBI director.
A year before his own assassination, Robert Kennedy confessed his deep suspicions to aide Richard Goodwin.
The one time I ever discussed it with Robert Kennedy, many years later, around 67, his own idea was if anybody else was involved, it was probably organized crime.
I don't doubt the involvement, Bill, but at a lower level.
Oh, come on.
Could the mob
get the Warren Commission appointed to cover it up? Mob wouldn't have the guts or the power for something of this magnitude. Assassins need payrolls, schedules, times, orders. This was a military-style ambush from start to finish. This was a coup d'etat with Lyndon Johnson waiting in the wings.
The final theory, number five, involves the military-industrial complex. It is the controversial thesis of Oliver Stone's film that Kennedy may have been killed to stop him from stopping the war in Vietnam.
There's no question in my mind whatsoever that John Kennedy would never have committed combat troops to a war in Southeast Asia. Never.
I spent much of September 63 working on the Kennedy plan for getting all U.S. personnel out of Vietnam by the end of 1965. This plan was one of the strongest, most important papers issued from the Kennedy White House.
The Mr. X character in JFK, played by Donald Sutherland, is based in part on this man, Colonel Fletcher Prouty.
At the time of the Kennedy assassination, I was the chief of special operations in the Joint Staff, working for the Joint Chiefs of Staff. Special operations in those days was a euphemism for the military support of the clandestine operations of CIA around the world.
Prouty was an insider who claimed that while some in the Pentagon were gearing up for war, he was secretly helping President Kennedy plan for peace.
During the summer, July, August, and September, he had a very experienced group of people work on his new policy for Vietnam. It was published in October, and it was called the National Security Action Memorandum number 263. And that memorandum, signed under the direction of the president, was to bring men home by Christmas and get everybody out by 1965.
What we're looking at here are approximately 15,000 pages of documents on Kennedy's Vietnam policies that I've collected from all the archives in the United States. In some cases, many of them are newly declassified.
In a new book, JFK and Vietnam, military historian Major John Newman offers his conclusions about Kennedy's Vietnam policy.
I don't think there's any doubt that JFK was pulling out of Vietnam when he was killed. And I think because the most fundamental tenet of his policy was no combat troops, and we know that Johnson put in combat troops, I feel it's safe to say that the assassination led directly to the escalation of the war.
Gentlemen, I want you to know I'm not going to let Vietnam go like China did. I'm personally committed, and I'm not going to take one soldier out of there till they know we mean business in Asia.
Did that policy change after the assassination?
Only 4 days later.
What happened?
4 days later, under Lyndon Johnson, they issued a new National Security Action Memorandum, number 273, which began a modest change. Then in March of 64, another memorandum, 288, began the attacks on North Vietnam and the escalation of the war.
And in my last conversation with him, I'll always remember it, he said, as soon as the election is over, I'm going to get the boys out of Vietnam. To myself, I've always said there would have been never that great disaster that we had, the loss of lives that he had he lived.
This view of the Vietnam War is disputed by many, including reporter turned historian Stanley Karnow.
We have people who were close to Kennedy who would like to believe that he would have gotten out of Vietnam in 1964, I think sort of rewriting history. He was very much a hardliner, very much a believer in the domino theory and all the conventional wisdom or ignorance of the time.
We are not there to see a war lost.
Newman's research has led him to believe that Kennedy may have been feigning right to move left, supporting the war publicly while privately planning to withdraw.
By 1963, Kennedy had a problem. That problem was his re-election. You have to reconcile this public record, and the public record itself is ambiguous because Kennedy makes statements, the Cronkite one, which appear to be, you know, it's their war, they'll have to fight it, and then there are these many public statements that indicate we should stay the course.
President, the only
In a September 1963 interview with Walter Cronkite, Kennedy voiced both views within seconds.
Quite obviously. I don't think that unless a greater effort is made by the government to win popular support, that the war can be won out there. In the final analysis, it's their war. They're the ones who have to win it or lose it. These people who say that we ought to withdraw from Vietnam are wholly wrong, because if we withdrew from Vietnam, the communists would control Vietnam.
I think it was very much a mixed mind about the pursuit of the war in Vietnam. It's what I would have expected him to say as a political statement, whether he was considering withdrawal or not. He would say he was not.
So Kennedy, to a certain degree, encouraged the American right to think that he was going to lead a serious American/free world campaign against godless communism. And then when he started pulling out of the very battles he had seemed to call for, many around him must have scratched their heads. Many must have said, what is this kid all about anyway? He's just jerking us around. Enough of this already. If only a lightning bolt would fall in the right place, we'd have Lyndon Johnson. And God knows Lyndon Johnson is not going to back away from these struggles.
At the very least, I think I would say that President Kennedy would not have pursued that war to the extent that his successor did, because they were different men. I've written a whole book on the subject. They were different men in different circumstances. But to go on from that and to extrapolate that therefore the military and the CIA and the FBI and Vice President Johnson conspired to murder President Kennedy, I think that takes that supposition too far.
I feel he was surrounded by enemies like Caesar. I think he was surrounded by old men. I don't think he knew who to trust anymore. He was making tentative steps in one direction, tentative steps in the other. I think he was a very beleaguered man and an ambivalent about how to deal with this Cold War machine that had been in place since World War II.
In the councils of government, we must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex.
President Eisenhower warned the nation of the dangers of the military-industrial complex. A permanent war economy was their business, with billions at stake.
The organizing principle of any society, Mr. Garrison, is for war. The authority of the state over its people resides in its war powers. And Kennedy wanted to end the Cold War in his second term.
Oliver Stone and others believe that President Kennedy made a fatal decision to challenge this war machine by planning to withdraw from Vietnam.
The way that struck people who were leaning toward the profits and the benefits of the Vietnam War was really unimaginable. You can't imagine. So a power elite coalesces. They don't have to vote. And among them, they say, you know, that guy's got a goal.
There's been no vote, nothing's on paper. There's no one to blame. It's as old as the crucifixion, a military firing squad.
They know who to turn to, who can get these trained, these skilled mechanics, we call them, not assassins, mechanics.
Maybe from a special camp we keep outside Athens, Greece, pros. Maybe locals, Cubans, mafia hire, separate teams.
Nobody will ever find them. There's no trace. They don't meet anybody. And yet, you should understand, it is their job.
This is too fucking big for you. You know that? This is who did the president? Who killed Kennedy? Fuck, man! It's a mystery. It's a mystery wrapped in a riddle, inside an enigma. The fucking shooters don't even know. Don't you get it?
The key thing, I think, that a lot of people don't lose sight of, the fact of, is that once you dismiss the communist thing, the foreign plot, and you've got the mob, the CIA, the FBI, the military, okay? We tend to think of those as separate entities. And yet, if we'll really stop and think about it, they're all interconnected.
There is no shortage of conspiracy theories about the Kennedy assassination. What is in short supply is conclusive evidence and smoking guns. What connects all of these theories is the sense that the Kennedy assassination gave the American people a first glimpse of powerful but hidden political and economic forces, many still at work today.
In other words, the study of the JFK assassination puts us in touch with what we have to regard as the number one agenda item facing us as a people, and that is the struggle against the secret state.
Well, I think one large lesson is the same lesson we should have learned from Vietnam and should have learned from the Gulf of Tonkin and should have learned from the Iranian deals and over and over and over again, and we never seem to learn it. You can't trust the government. You got to think things through for yourself.
The Assassination Archive in Washington, D.C. is not far from the White House. It is a different kind of CIA, a citizens' intelligence agency fighting to pry documents from uncooperative government officials. Lawyer Jim Lassar is its curator.
This is an example of documents obtained under the Freedom of Information Act. Unfortunately, as you can see, the government frequently withholds extensive portions of the documents that they release. It's fair to say that there are in excess of 500,000 pages of records in the government that have some possible bearing on questions involved in the Kennedy assassination that the American public has yet to see. I think it's highly ironic that the ABC news program Nightline recently was given access by the KGB in the Soviet Union to the very kind of information that the CIA withholds from the American public.
Global Vision, the producers of this documentary, asked the CIA to open itself to cameras the way the KGB granted access to ABC. A senior CIA official denied the request, noting the public and the press have no right to see their files. The letter states that unlike the KGB, the CIA is embarked on no such public relations campaign.
Well, there is a simple way to determine if I am paranoid. Let's ask the two men who profited the most from the assassination, your former president, Lyndon Baines Johnson, and your new president, Richard Nixon, to release the 51 CIA documents pertaining to Lee Harvey Oswald and Jack Ruby.
Nothing has been brought to my attention that would in any way indicate that the original conclusions of the Warren Commission were wrong.
Former CIA Director President George Bush, like his predecessors, is against releasing still classified files on the Kennedy assassination.
I'm sure that whatever is needed to bring light on this conspiratorial theory can be done. I've always been very careful about releasing classified information.
The fight for full disclosure goes on.
Do you believe that some people's belief is that there should be more items declassified?
We're for all of the, any items that are out of our control, clearly. And the other items, they obviously ought to be made available.
We have a right to know, and we feel like the American people deeply feel like we don't know why we were in Vietnam. We don't know what forces were opposed to John Kennedy. You know, the same men that showed up at his funeral despised this man and had other agendas where he's concerned. We didn't know that. I mean, we got J. Edgar Hoover's name all over buildings all over America. And what we know about J. Edgar Hoover now is not very flattering, and in most instances, it seems almost criminal. You know, we have a right to know.
This film is about Stone trying to find the soul of America, someplace that got blasted away in Dallas.
It's about time that this has been exposed. This has been covered up. People have been asleep. They've been walking around in a coma.
We felt that we lost our Camelot.
Let's put it this way. I did not know there were four bullets.
I think they should open the case back up, you know.
If half of it is true, then the American public is really just duped.
I don't believe it was a single bullet. I think it was lots of bullets.
I've always believed there was a conspiracy. This whole Warren Commission thing, it was very difficult for me to believe that one person did this.
To live through this movie is to live through it again, and it happened just as fast when it happened as it happened in the movie. And it overwhelms you. It did then, it still does today.
I'm young, I hope to God I can be another Jim Garrison.
I might be dead and gone, but I hope and pray that the truth will come out someday.
I definitely want to live in a world where things like a conspiracy to assassinate a president don't happen.